Every year in London, for the last 40 years, the South London Warlords organise the biggest wargame and miniature warfare exhibition in the country. This year, no exception, we have an absolutely incredible attendance to what has become an absolutely iconic trade show in the whole country and for the whole calendar year. Welcome to London Salute. The miniatures is something that definitely everybody pays a lot of attention to, and few people pay better attention to quality than heresy. There's definitely no heresy in the amount of effort that goes into creating your stuff. You guys, I mean, you are the mega head sculpting honcho of heresy. Tell me a little bit about what is the philosophy of your company and what kind of miniatures you guys do.
I started out with the main intention at the time of doing figures that either weren't done elsewhere or weren't done very well elsewhere. I've grown up a wargamer since the age of 12. I always wanted to make my own figures. And so I just sort of drifted into it and ended up doing it. I thought, I can do that, I'll have a go at that.
And you actually do it very well. You have over there the coolest ever sculpted dragon on earth.
Thanks. I do, but it's a long and terrible tale, the old dragon. Basically, it was an idea that I had in Christmas 2008, where I sat down over the Christmas break, because I take 2 weeks off at Christmas. Hooray! And I thought, I'd really like to have a go at making a big dragon. And someone told me on a forum somewhere that I'd never be able to do it. Now, foolishly, I thought, oh yeah. So I'll have a go, and I thought it would take me about 2 months. But what happened was that the more I worked on it, the more work there was. Because I was doing it, I asked on a forum, how do you want your dragon to look? I ran a poll, and the options came back, scaled, this length of neck, these kind of wings, this many legs. And doing scales by hand on that monster turned out to be a nightmare. Which got worse and worse and worse, and the more you work with sculpting, it's very much a creative flow thing. You have the energy, you have the enthusiasm. When it gets beyond 3 months, and you're still working on the same figure, it gets difficult. It took me 3 years. So the problem was that I have a very supportive fan base of customers, and I showed them the work in progress pictures. And I said, oh, I'll probably be finished in 2 months. And they all said, oh, great, can we pre-order it? And I thought, well, I suppose you're going to have to wait until it's finished. And I thought I'd only sell about 30 of them. And what happened is that a lot of people pre-ordered it. A lot. And then I had a resin guy who's helping, and he thought he'd be quite easy to produce. So there was no worries there, except that as time went on, it got bigger and more detailed and more complicated. When the 3 years were up and I finally finished it, and the resin guy tried to make it, it turned out to be very technically difficult indeed. And unfortunately, here we are, you know, a year and a bit into the production, and we still haven't got very many of them out. So we've got a huge list of people waiting for it, a nightmare to actually get the stock for. But I should be now able to spin cast half of the dragon myself, which means that all those 200 people waiting will finally get their dragon at some point soon. Hooray! So this time next year, when I come to Salute, I should have a nicely painted dragon that you'll be able to actually buy in a box, which would be great.
That would be absolutely amazing, because seriously, it looks absolutely incredible. I'm a massive dragon fan, and I've never seen anything like that. It looks absolutely gorgeous. But you have a pretty huge range of all sorts of stuff that also look fantastic. What is your production schedule like? Because I can imagine you being pretty busy.
I am very busy because I don't just do the sculpting. I also do the websites, the mold making, empty the bins, all the other jobs that you have to do on a day-to-day thing to run a business. So unfortunately, sculpting isn't something I always get time to do, otherwise the range would be even bigger. But yeah, basically, if I have an idea, I go with it, you know what I mean? I tend not to have a schedule as such, just more of a, let's get this thing out of my head and into a figure sort of thing.
And do you sculpt by hand, or are you a computer-based sculptor?
By hand.
You're mad.
Thanks. I would love to do it by computer, but I don't know how to work the 3D CAD type programs and things. I would love to learn how to do that, but learning how to do it for free is the trick.
True. No, but what I mean that you're mad is because the amount of detail that goes into those figures, I mean, that's insane.
Well, most sculptors are mad. I think if you ask anybody who deals with a sculptor what they're like, they'll say he's mad. You know what I mean?
Where can people find out about your miniatures? Where can people buy them? Do you ship internationally? What's your business model like?
We ship internationally, yeah, worldwide. My miniatures have been to every part of the world, and I haven't. That's the odd thing. There are a few traders that carry our lines. Fantasization in America, for one. Battlefield Berlin in Germany. We're always looking for more, obviously. But yeah, we have a website, heresyminiatures.com. So everyone can get them on there. The shipping's charged at cost. It's always, we tend to try and get everything out by the end of the next day. And it's all very, we pride ourselves on doing things as well as possible and as quickly as possible for the customer.
You're still casting metal? Do you also do resin, pressing? What kind of materials do you guys use?
We're casting in metal at the moment. We're venturing into resin. At the minute, I'm experimenting with spin casting the dragon, like I say. So there's those two. We make the molds and everything with a big press at the moment. I would like to learn how to do the old vacuum RTV molds and things like that. More because I just love finding things out. But yeah, at the moment everything is in a metal alloy for the most part.
Well, I'm absolutely convinced that you're going to be incredibly successful. I mean, I presume I've been about 20 minutes trying to talk to you, so I'm guessing that you've been busy this salute.
I've been quite busy this salute, yes. Answering a lot of questions, mainly from people wondering where their dragon is. sorry.
Best of luck. I really hope that you guys do incredibly well. I absolutely love your miniatures. They look absolutely fantastic.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. It means a lot.
Pleasure. Of course, it's absolutely pointless to have a game hobby if you don't have a place where to buy games. And at least in the UK, very, very few come close to leisure games. They've been here forever. And not just they've been here forever, but they've been here forever knowing exactly what they're doing. And this gentleman here, Mr. Michael, knows exactly what he's doing when it's about games. Michael, leisure games, you've been going on for 15, 20, 30, 40 years?
I'm about 26 now.
So since you were 12?
Yes, that's right.
Now, what makes, I know what makes Leisure Game an amazing shop, because I know you, but the people on the other side of the camera may not know you. What do you do? What kind of games do you stock?
Well, we try to stock as wide a range as possible. We stock as much as we can of as many different types of games as we can. Anything from role-playing games, board games, miniatures games, historical war, board games, you name it, we try and stock it.
And you are yourself, you are very, very proactive in actually getting to know your games. I mean, you are the kind of guy who goes to Essen in a van with a baby and buys lots of games to really make sure you have amazing stuff that nobody else does. You are into your games.
I love them. I love playing them. And certainly you mentioned Essen. That's a fantastic chance to go and really have a great time. At the same time, it's a business opportunity, looking for the new games as soon as they come out, trying to see the new ones coming out and get them in stock as soon as possible.
And you love it.
I do. Essen is a fantastic few days because you can get to play some games with some great people as well.
You have continued, I mean, as I was saying earlier, you have been as a serious business going on for a very, very long time, and you have gone through the ups and downs of market and facing the online boom. What do you think makes a shop a good shop? What's the secret or not so secret of your success?
Well, I think things are changing slightly. We've always thought of our main strength as the wide range of games that we stock, and that's still very important indeed today. But we're beginning now, over the last year or so, to try to move more into having some organised play going on in the shop. We're running a few tournaments, trying to get local people more involved in actually playing in the store, and also conventions, going around the conventions, getting ourselves known as widely as possible. And I think that's a very, very important thing as well for us.
And you're actually as well very proactive and very active in the online media scene. You do your Twitter account, you have a well-stocked and up-to-date website. Have you found that to be something necessary, or do you think it might be a fluke, I'm just going to try?
I think it's necessary because it's another avenue of getting people to know you, to know us and what we're about. I must admit, Twitter is something I haven't mastered myself. One of my colleagues does that. When he first insisted that we got a Twitter account, I was very sceptical. But I think that's the sort of thing these days that people want, and it works, I think.
How often do you store your shop? What can people expect to see when they get to the shop? And how can you get specialist games for them?
We can always try. We aim to keep anything that we can get in stock. But of course, the massive ranges that are available these days makes that pretty much impossible. So yeah, if there are things that we don't have, we'll do our best to get them.
Where are you online? Where are you on Twitter?
Right, online, our website is www.leisuregames.com. Facebook, we are just Leisure Games, all as one word. Twitter, I think, is Leisure Games UK or Leisure Games _UK. I must admit to not knowing that one off the top of my head.
I think you can be forgiven for that one. How has been Salute so far for you guys?
It's been very busy. Looking around and speaking to the organisers, it's busier than last year, which is very nice. There's been lots of sales. I'm happy. It's been a great day.
And may they keep coming.
Indeed, yes.
Of course, not all is fun and games when it comes to warfare. And the guys from Hell from Heroes are people who know that only so well. It is very nice to see a very well-stocked booth for this absolutely amazing charity who is, I was going to say manned, but I'm going to say womaned by a super volunteer, Benny Epps. Benny, what are you doing here? Why do you come to these shows?
This is the first year I've personally attended. Just think it goes hand in hand with a wargaming event.
How are you finding it so far? People being receptive to it? Are you finding a lot of interest?
Very supportive, second to none. Wherever I go, it's always very supportive, but very much so here.
Excellent. Now, for the people who watch our channel around the world, what does Help for Hero do exactly?
It helps support the wounded soldiers that are hurt, injured in action on the front line.
I presume you're seeing a bit too much of that at the moment.
Unfortunately so, yes.
What kind of activities do you organise for the war men and women who come back from battle?
Myself personally, I do a lot of merchandise sales, such as today, cake sales. And I also do sporting activities to raise money for Help for Heroes as well.
If people wanted to donate to your cause and find out more what kind of activities, or even volunteer for you, where could they go to find out?
Yep, we have a website, helpforheroes.org.uk.
And what is it about War for Heroes that attracts you personally?
It's something that my eldest son got me involved with. He has friends now out in the army, in action, so it's very close to our hearts.
I can imagine, and quite scary at times, I presume.
At times, yes.
Well, hopefully you will not have to suffer any of the consequences of that dreadful war.
Fingers crossed.
Best of luck with that, and I really hope it goes very well indeed.
Thank you.
Pleasure. If there is anything that's in heaps around Salute this year, is passion. But I can fairly safely say that none have put more effort into the outfits and the accuracy as these people here from the Crown and Empire Club. I know nothing about you guys other than, and because you've told me earlier, you are from the French army. He's a French general. The rest, I have no idea, so I need to be informed. You, I have been told, are the key of the knowledge, and you know everything there is to know. So, please tell us a little bit, what do you guys do? What are you all about?
Well, we reenact Napoleonic Wars. Basically, the gentleman in the middle is a Frenchman. He's a... You're general? Yeah, French general. Gentleman on the end is British cavalry, light cavalry. This gentleman here is a slightly earlier period, 1793 to 1797, York Rangers artillery. Mm-hmm. You can tell he's artillery, he's got red facings on. And I'm light infantry of the Napoleonic era.
So yours can be said is game at human scale. You don't do just the miniatures, you actually do the whole shebang.
That's right. You should see the size of the dice.
Yeah, I bet that's going to be huge. What does attract you to do this kind of stuff? Because it's quite time consuming, and you do need to put an awful lot of effort into it. What's interesting for you about it?
For me, well, the main thing is making friends and learning about history. It's always been, for me, this sheer excitement. You've got the battles, but then you've got the sheer knowledge of coming in what's after it and everything like that.
And how do you choose who you're going to be? Because you look impressive enough to be a general. How do you decide if somebody comes to you and say, I want to be the general, tell them no?
We generally suggest that they might like to start at the bottom for a while and see how it goes.
Do they accept?
Usually, if they're serious, yes.
So what kind of activities are you going to? I mean, when we say reenactment, and I ask this because we have an awful lot of people watching from all over the world who are not as familiar, and definitely most of them will not look as impressive. When you say reenactment, what do you guys do exactly? You haven't spoken to me just yet.
Well, we reenact basically the life and times of the person that we portray. We try and go into basic details of the food, the clothing, as close as we can, but not with the diseases that used to go with these guys. I mean, nobody wants to die of dysentery after a reenactment for drinking muddy water in Spain, things like that, or living on the typhoid islands. We try and create history as much as we can for the modern era so we can educate in schools as well, because history comes to life doing it like this. You can read and read and read and read, but unless you're doing it like this, you're not living it.
What kind of events do you go to? Do you go all over the country, or...?
We go all over the world if need be. Some of our people are going to Canada later this year for the War of 1812. We do a lot of events in Spain, and Waterloo is pretty much every year, which you'll find some of us at.
What's your favourite kind of event, the ones that you really go for it and enjoy more than anything?
I think the events in Spain and Portugal are the best ones. Particularly if we've got a fortress or a castle to attack.
Where in Spain? Because I must admit, I'm Spanish, and I feel absolutely complete shame in admitting full ignorance about reenactment in my country, apart from the Moorish and Christians in the East Coast once a year. But other than that, I have no idea. Where do you guys go in Spain so I can go and see you at some point?
The big one this year will be at Salamanca.
Oh, that's a very historical place, yes.
Salamanca and La Albuera is every year. The actual battle was 1811, but we've been doing it for several years now. The big anniversary was last year, of course, the 200th. Other places, well, within the time frame of Crown and Empire, which is more than just Napoleonic Wars, in 2010 I was at Zaragoza for the 300th anniversary. I had the privilege of commanding the Allied army against the French and Spaniards there.
Who won?
We did. Yes.
When you say we, you mean
the Anglo-Portuguese army. Oh. Yes.
Sorry. That's the right one.
The surrender from a Frenchman.
As it should be, sir. As it should be.
Today, I am a Frenchman.
Thank you so much, guys. It's been an absolute pleasure talking to you. You look absolutely incredible, and I very much look forward to seeing you back in Spain when we're there. Thank you very much. And this is it for the first episode on Salute 2012. Next episode we will bring you more interviews with very interesting people that promise to be very, very entertaining. Until the next time, I hope you enjoyed it.